jammer om inte Frans gör det, checka.
Acoustic music to be found in the 60s by Louis Anderson, Misha Engelberg, and Gustav Mahler, who were the senior Dutch composers since the last time going on. And the original impetus for the creation of Stein was a particular piece of music that they were producing at that time. And Stein was a spin-on, a sort of consequence of that piece. And that particular style of concentrating on particular musical pieces has continued through the history of Stein, in that most of the work we do is not so much research for general purpose studies, but dedicated research to particular musical products, particular performances that are planned. And I should say something first about what we're going to do this afternoon. I'm going to talk a little bit in general about the so-called philosophical aspects of instrument design and sound. And then there'll be a brief description of what we call Sensor Lab, which is our analog to MIDI device that we're offering to the public. And that'll be followed by a description of one of the more recent instruments, the MIDI conductor system we've made, and a description of software written by Frank Walday for the Archaic Symphony by Michel Weiss, which again has become more generalized into a product which we would love to share with other people. And that'll be followed then by a description of the web, which is the last and most recent instrument that Michel Weiss has designed, and the demonstration of that as well as description. The real title, I think, for this presentation should be Music from Somewhere. So I think as opposed to Music from Nowhere. And the reason for that is the reason I say music from somewhere is that the emphasis of Stein has been on creating tangible attachments to computers. I think the problem with computers is that being such logical and abstract machines, there's an attraction to the idea of invisibility, the idea of the intangibility or non-existence of the real thing, being the idea of computers really manifesting and expressing the time. And there's a danger, it's kind of idealistic stuff, idealistic attraction, that results in often instruments which have no instrumentality, instruments which have no physicality. There are so many instruments that have been designed even by ourselves in recent years in which, by merely moving your hands through the air, it's just to create music. And I think fundamentally, that's a dangerous path to follow. The computer is abstract enough. Most of the work that we have to do as computer programmers, as musicians, is to bring concreteness to the computer, to bring models to the computer, usually from way outside computer science, from perhaps the natural sciences, and the history of music, and who knows what inspiration. But these models have to be mapped into the rather primitive, abstract, logical space of computers as they exist today. And despite the improvements of algorithms, there isn't a lot that computers have to offer in conceptualization. So the problem is you're trying to map models, and the wonderful thing about doing it in the way we do at Stein is that one, you're forced, and multiple, certainly at Stein is real time, it's all performance oriented, as I said, performance oriented software and hardware, and real time. So we immediately have a somewhere that we're coming from, namely the limited possibilities of the hardware that we use, of the real time of the screen. And that's, to us, a great advantage because we don't have to spend a lot of time pondering whether we want to wait 1 minute, 1 hour, 1 day, 1 week, or 1 year for a conversation to come. we have to do the performance. And it turns out that in creating instruments for performance, we've also created instruments for composition, because these phantom models that we're putting into the computer, projecting into the computer in some way, get physical handles on them. And in a sense, it's not clear whether the instruments we're making are more important as performance tools or as ways to understand how the ideas for judging the computer can be turned into composition. Because it's really wonderful to have your own nervous system directly connected to the ideas that you're trying to develop as a composer. And I think to get concrete, I'll talk about some of the instruments we've made recently in the last, say, couple of years, most of which have been made using a synth board developed by Peter Cox, who is one of our electrical engineers, and he'll give some details about the construction of that and the utilization of that computer. But it's a small industrial controller type microprocessor. And the first instrument we made was for Nick Collins, who's a New York composer. And he had found a Wheatstone concertina, Wheatstone with the Wheatstone Bridge, and it was supposed to be a number of possible electricity. Apparently, Wheatstone not only discovered a way to measure, to make accurate measures of electricity, but he also invented the hexagonal concertina. And we found an original one, and Nick Collins wanted to turn this into a modern instrument, so he put a small automobile speaker inside the concertina and replaced all the original levers with electrical switches. And we added a hexagonal circuit board, which converted the orientation and the breadth and the distance of the bellows, basically the proximity of the edges of the concertina to each other, and converted that into MIDI and produced his concertina, which is still pretty much trying to figure out how to do this. After that, we had a really interesting experience with John Rose. John Rose is a violinist who has built his career on making exotic modifications to the violin and playing rather extravagant improvised style. He's very successful. He's a great violin. And he has a series of concerts in Berlin called Belgian Violin, which is the first one of his. This year, I think it's going to be an ongoing series as well. And he had never used electronics before. He was one of those sophisticated musicians who felt that basically there was nothing that computers and electronics could do for him. And he came to us, though, he had an idea that he wanted to do a Paganini piece. He wanted to take the bow, lift it from the violin, and continue to make music with the bow alone. And he has a piece in which he actually uses two bows and plays them together as instruments using the pairs. And he wanted to extend this to just bowing in the air. Conducting the orchestra. And so what we did is we took an ultrasound transducer, which is just one of our ordinary, something we've used for the hands, Michelle Weiss's, for those of you who have seen Michelle's. We took this particular simple transducer pair, put the transmitter on the bottom of the bow, and put the receiver on the microphone stand on the floor in front of the stage, and he proceeded to make a really amazing piece of music just by using a single parameter of the distance of the bow to the floor on his hand. It's a very extravagant performance. He was able to bring in, and he used all the stage tricks and imagery and incredible beautiful gestures. Produced music just by taking a series of maps of distance to MIDI key. This is a really exciting project for us because it worked so well and it took no effort at all. It's just an extra use of the pre-existing instrument. And so that, in a sense, inspired the next step, which is try to make a little bit more general version of the hardware that we've been building for other people's instruments. At the same time, we had a request from a musician in The Hague, Michael Barker, who is a bass recorder player, that he wanted to convert it into, and he uses extensively his prepared to extend it. And he wanted to extend it into sampling and And Peter, who's working on this, is a rather long-term project, is the delicacy of the transition. Peter did some stuff about how we're doing that. And let's see, we also converted a melodica in the early stage of this project into a mini melodica. And the connector, the latest one, the one you're going to see demonstrated today. And this is a version of Michel's hands. This is an instrument Michel himself made. He's decided that he would make a version of the hands to share with other people. And he tried to make one that had a little bit more variety. His own pair, he used to do the touch monkeys, grew out of his own personal solution to the problem of creating a musical system out of software and various synthesizers and samplers and his own personal need. I don't know if any of you know the story of how Michel started the music. He discovered one day by putting fingers on the pins of the EMS synth, he could control the synthesizer just by changing the rest of the hand capacitance of the circuitry. He was so inspired by this that he turned the synth inside out and brought many of the solder pads from the inside of the synthesizer out to the outside, and created what we call the crackle boxes, which is a series of synthesizers where you could actually place his hands into the circuitry of the analog synthesizer. And I think that the MIDI hands, the hands that he uses for his pieces, are an obvious extension of his desire to get hands-on, in this case, in a MIDI synthesizer, MIDI hand, which is the original MIDI. And now, you'll see in the web, an even more interesting extension is that they're getting more. But this particular instrument is, again, a handle. In this case, it's designed for particular size hands, because it counts. You'll see three others, because it's your concert 4 o'clock, and there should be three of these instruments used. In totally independent systems playing together, each with their own microprocessor, there's a lot to go through. But basically what this consists of is a bunch of switches, just switches which can be mapped into MIDI and then converted by software from direct playing. The original hands, well, for the touch monkeys piece that shows it, is direct playing. You play everything as if you were a keyboard player, except you're modifying the keyboard. Plus the addition of this ultrasound continuous controller. So there's a pair of ultrasound sender receivers between the two hands, and they allow you to use the distance between the hands and the motion, the accelerations between the hands as a continuous controller. And there's also another channel of continuous control, which is this exotic. But again, this particular instrument was unusual for us because in the past all the instruments were made for a particular composer or musician, usually with their direct, and always with their total direct involvement in making the instrument. In this case, this is an instrument which Michel made for, in fact, an unknown consumer, because the band, they put together this piece. Only came into existence on his band as collaborators in this piece several months after the instrument was finished, or at least several minutes after the instrument was finished. Very quickly made instrument. I just want to talk about two things.
No, the only one is the first prototype in Ireland's way. Because there was a conversation with the business.
That's right.
And he made the first versions. After that, it took about 3 or 4 months to remake the picture.
So basically, the project started at this time last year and was running by January. Yeah. So that's pretty good. Pretty fast. And most of that work consisted in the mechanical problem, because the circuitry work made the mechanical part. And that turns out to be one which no one really has any expertise in at the time. Anyway, so that we ask people to come, but please bring your own mechanical ideas. And of course, bring you in the same place. You're the only person who knows what you would like, how you would like to feel music with someone I talked to today. And she was looking for a soft touch version of instrument, something that you could deform and have weight in your hands and use the way it is. But what we're providing here, what the sensor lab is just the glue from analog MIDI. I just wanted to say a few more things, say a few more sort of anti-Cartesian things. I think perhaps again, due to the abstractness and the appeal of abstraction that the computer environment encourages, it also encourages a kind of Cartesianism, reducing everything to a colorless space and spatial model. And while it has great appeal and from an aesthetic point of view, if you're a visual artist or a geometrician, I think that for music, that's not enough. And I think the key word to describe instrumentation is effort. I think too much of the way people approach the views is looking for something for nothing. You know, it's supposed to be the machine that makes life easier, as everyone knows. It's not. There's no labor-saving aspect of computer work that I've ever experienced. I'm sure it's tripled any work I have to attempt to do on solving a particular problem. The second thing is this idea of effortlessness. Again, perhaps the reason for making invisible instruments where you wave your hands through space and there's no resistance at all, that for some reason has an appeal, it's a dangerous appeal. Because there's no reason, there's no tradition in history that musical instruments have gotten especially easier to play. They've been rationalized, they become more repeatable, they stay in tune better. But I don't think there's kind of a natural tendency to get basically simpler all the time, maybe the keyboards. But I was talking to Roger Denver just a couple of days ago, and I've heard jazz musicians talk about this, the idea that in the history of jazz, the trumpet has often been the instrument of innovation, and their theory of jazz musician theory is because the trumpet is so difficult to play, and because it puts you in such an exotic space of effortful space. And I think it's effort that puts structure into the otherwise blankness of, say, rationalized pitch space or rationalized time space, spaces among others. But effort is what binds this complexity into time and into space. Without effort, you don't have these rich structures that, for example, Emery Trumpeter knows about. But effort is also the source of the impulse and desire and the energy of music. And if you remove the effort, then in a sense you're removing the possibilities for this kind of expression. And we haven't really gone that far in putting the effort back. It's something that we're conscious of all the time. It's a difficult thing because the mechanical part, like I say, is the most difficult part of building an instrument. The electronics is pretty well taken care of. We're very popular to do as a very simple solution for simple instruments. I mean, another example of this effortlessness, I think, is the idea of using the mouse as a controller. For example, spatialization of sound, thinking that it's a problem of drawing a picture of where the sound should go. That makes about as much sense to me as drawing a picture of where you want your car to go with the landscape. It wouldn't be a very successful way to drive a car, except in an absolutely flat, flat landscape. But it wouldn't be a way to drive the car. You have to control acceleration at the pace of driving the car, not location. And I think the same thing is true. A couple of years ago, when GMP7 came out, we made a quadraphonic spatialization program for the GMP7s. And the effort was to control acceleration with some sort of sensible control, as opposed to just drawing a picture of where the sound should go. Space appeals, of course. The idea of control, being able to control everything, is very attractive. I think that it's a dangerous path to follow. Pure control, unbridled control, and effort is what counters that. Okay, so I just want to say a little bit about, again, about the generality that the idea of generality. We it's time to work mostly from particular work from particular instrument design, particular composition. And so for us, generality is at the end of it, we tend to start. And I'm not saying that that's the only way to do it, it's just that's how we work. And so this set of tools we'll show you are byproducts of particular pieces of music and particular concepts that we're doing.
And Peter, do you want to give a description of the object?
As you can see on this diagram here, it's consisting of a main CPU card, which contains the embedded microcontroller that Joe was talking about, and another board which holds additional logic to get all the analog channels into the CPU. Here, as you can see, there are 32 analog channels which are scaled and offsetted by this part here, which go to the CPU, and then the CPU has got 8 analog channels. So the leftover 7 channels we make so that you can, well, they're mapped in the software so that you can read analog keys. Now we'd like to explain a bit about that. If you take a resistive network which gives off 4 voltages, and each key mixes these voltages to the input of these lines, then you can read them by converting it to digital and only looking at the 4 bits. Then there's the ultrasonic part, which Joe was also talking about. And with that, you can measure distance. In our system, you can connect 3 preprocessed systems, so you can make a 3-dimensional space with that. Then there's a normal standard key scan with diodes, diode matrix, for 64 keys. And another part of the box is that we've got 16 output lines, TTL output lines, with which you can drive LEDs, relays. So you've got some control for the outside world. Then there's also 32K of RAM on board, in which all parameters are stored. And this RAM has got battery backup, so that if you turn off the power, it will remain in there. And of course, there's MIDI. Here's all, again, written out. I would like to say something about the size of the board. This is the CPU board, which is quite small. That's why I'm fitting the small box you can see on the floor. This almost contains all the logic needed to make an instrument. And as you can see, this is the other board I was talking about. This is mainly this big because of the connectors that are on the front. And that's why it's a prototyping environment, because you can connect your sensors to these connectors. And then there's only this much of logic needed to read all the inputs. And, well, as you saw, it's quite big, but if you want a project where you really know how the instrument should look, and you found it by testing it, then we can make the box in that size. And you can carry it around because what the performance like to take as little as possible. Then I would like to tell something about the sensors that we use. It's time we have used standard switches for the keys. And for that you can use almost any switch, like even a light switch if you want. The switches only need a diode to the interface to the box, or if you want to do an analog, you need some resistors. Then we've got the wall effect, which I would like to show on the screen. It's about this size. It looks like a normal transistor, which works with an additional magnet, which is also quite small. And you can use this to measure small distances. As you can see, well, about a centimeter or something like that. As you can see, it needs no additional circuitry, so you can just connect it to the box, because the box supplies the power needed for the device. And then we use pressure sensors. And in pressure sensors, you've got different forms. You've got the ones that work with a miter sheet with carbon. But as we found out, the DX7 aftertouch bar, which looks like this, only a bit longer. It's quite good to put into instruments because you can cut it into small pieces. And the web that's standing over here uses that. Well, you can't see it, but they're in there in the aluminum pieces. And they're also on the conductor that's lying over there. So we found out that it's really good to use instead of the other one. And then there's the ultrasound, which is also a quite small device, but you need some additional circuits for that. And we can provide some edits. It's not much, it's about this big, it's amplifier. And, well, you may ask yourself, what do I need to know about hardware to make an instrument? I can say, not much. If you can handle it solar-eye, you can do it. Because if you only want some keys, you need a couple of diodes, and we can provide schematics how to connect these. So I think that's what you need to know. And if you want to do something more sophisticated, bring in a technician or ask us. I think this brings us to the MIDI part of the box, because without MIDI it would be worthless, of course. The box, you can program it so that it can send any type of MIDI message, like standard, key on, key off, with velocity, continuous controllers, program changes. All the standard MIDI messages are in there. Then there are, you can also send a system exclusive with it, which is particularly useful if you want to change the timbre of the synthesizer. Because, well, Frank will show that later on, he's using the K1. And he's using a particular topic of the machine that you can change, like editing the sound, through MIDI. So you don't need additional computers to do so. Then the system also merges the incoming MIDI data, because there is a MIDI in and a MIDI out, of course, for programming also. It will merge the incoming data with the outgoing stream that you generate with your sensors. And this is useful if you've got a MIDI setup and you want to connect the box into it. You can just plug it in and it will merge all the data for you, so you don't need additional merges. Then you can get high resolution information if you use ultrasound sensors. You can do, well, up to 14 bits or even higher to take longer distances. And for 14 bits you need about 2 meters of working space. Then just again 32K RAM, which about covers the standard MIDI that you can do with it. Then we also provided some more advanced MIDI, as we call it, that you can reduce the information from the sensor that you're sending. So for instance, if you don't want to use an additional computer and you only want some small changes out of the sensor, you can do it by filtering the data. So that if you're pressing a sensor, it will generate quite a lot of information, of course. And that will be reduced by system. This is done through an interpreter, sort of programming language. And with that, you can also switch on levels so that the instrument gets a different meaning when you press a sensor harder or press a key. And you can also do response shaping. That means that all the data generated by the system, you can convert through a table. So your data is the input to the table. And you can fill the table through MIDI with a programming device. So that it converts it into another number. Well, I guess that's about what I want to say about advanced MIDI. You can do much more, but then you really need to go into the system. And as I said, it's a sort of programming language.
This is kind of open area, because every composer has a different way of dealing with the information you can get from the instrument. And some of our customers are poor enough that they can't or don't want to carry a personal computer on them, because they already have two suitcases full of violins and cello pieces and broken bits and pieces of bows or something. But it's designed in such a way that the person who needs to do more more analysis, and it's really going to carry interest in the room that way. But a lot of possibilities are squeezed into the box, but I don't recommend everybody try to deal with it at that low level, because there's no reason to be something that you want to do.
Well, then we've got the topic of dynamic scale. Working at Stein, and working there now for 3 years, I found out to make an instrument that you need the ability to scale the incoming signal. And the best description of, or well, example showing why, is the project I'm working on now, is the bass recorder, as Joel was already telling. On the bass recorder, there is a big tube in our valve cell. The valves are measured with a ball effect sensor. But the valve can travel for a distance to close it, and that's about 8 millimeters. And in that range, I'm measuring velocity through the analog signal. But after closing the valve, which gives me my key on, there's still some movement of it, which is sort of out of touch. And that's only about 2 millimeters, and for some valves even less, and some valves a bit more. And to get the full range information out of this, you need to rescale the sensor. That means that you have two sets of scaling factors. And at the moment, the velocity is calculated and the key is on. It will be switched between the two sets, and the pressure is measured, and then it's in the full 8-bit range of the system that's there. And it's also useful for the performer to be able to scale while he's performing. For instance, the breath controller, there's a breath controller in the system. Michael Barker, when he's playing, sometimes he doesn't want the synthesizer to react on his play, so then he scales the breath controller up a bit, so that he has to go harder to get it to react on his play. So that's why we made that in there, in the system that's there. I think this is about what we have to do with talk about.
Yeah, the next step, of course, is providing some sort of software that can consume the control information to shape the response. And as an example of that, we have Frank Lay, who's going to talk about the Lid Machine, which is a program that he and Michelle.
It's a MIDI performance program which would allow you to use pre-recorded sequences of MIDI data and trigger them at any time, and also during your performance to be able to control certain grounds of those sequences. But out of that, we finally realized the program, the Lid Machine, and the Lid in this case stands for sequence, small sequence, because basically we experienced that people who are using the program are using small sequences. The Lid Machine is what we call a MIDI controlled real-time composition arranger and performance manipulator. And the idea is that before your performance you will record these links. So you will use a MIDI transmitter to record basic MIDI material. These links can be stored and be used later on, and you assign a link to a key. That is that a MIDI node number can trigger that link. So whenever a node on comes in, let's say you have assigned a link to key number C3. When node on C3 arrives, then the link will start, and node on obviously will stop. So this way you can have up to 8 links running at the same time. But that's not only it. I mean, while those lids are running, you can also control a number of grounds. All the all these grounds, of course, can be stored. And the whole setup of the program can be stored on disk, so you can use it later during your performance. And I will go into a little bit more detail when I show the sheets. Big advantage of the whole system is that if you don't really need that much equipment, you need a MIDI transmitter capable of sending multi-fans with variable velocity. And of course you need the program to do all this. And it runs on any Atari ST. You can use the smallest one, however you want. And you need a synthesizer, of course, to translate your MIDI into sound. Okay, the first part of the program is actually not four parts. It's a recorder. The recorder is basically a three-track sequencer in which you can record your MIDI data. When you play the recording, you see a list like this. It shows you 12 events at a time. And all the individual events can be edited. Times can be changed, values can be changed, whatever. And you can also do cut, copy, paste for selected events, things like that. It's not really a very fancy graphically laid out sequencer, but since that was not the goal of the program to be just another fancy sequencer, we decided that if you want to do fancy editing, just use another program and save that sequence or link as a MIDI file, and then later on you can import it into the MIDI machine to use it. So when your recording has been successful, you will store the link into the library, and in the library you can have up to 256 links, and of course that's a little bit depending on how much memory your computer has, because, well, the links are quite big, and probably you want to get 256 links in the library, but, well, the people who have been using the program this far never run into problems. After you have a number of links in the library, you can make an arrangement. So that means that you will assign links to key numbers. And for example, in this one, DSHAR3 is the lick conga, and it plays on MIDI channel 6, and its type is loop, and that means that whenever a lick reaches its end, it will restart automatically, and we have some other types as well, which you can use. And it also shows you that this is only valid for preset number 3. The program allows you to have up to 128 presets, and each preset might have different lick arrangements. It also might have different performance parameter controls. So this way you can be quite flexible. When you've made the arrangement, you will see on this window, just as a visual feedback, which licks are that are licks assigned to a number of keys. In this case, for example, C3, D3, D-sharp, and F3 all have licks connected to them, and C3 and D-sharp3 are running at this moment because so this gives you a visual indication that something is going on. You can change, by the way, the layout of this window. On purpose, we decided that we didn't want a traditional keyboard layout because we didn't want the program to be particularly suitable for only keyboards. I mean, as I said, you can use any MIDI transmitter. And so you can make your own layout. I mean, if you want a keyboard layout, you can change the size of the boxes and whatever, and get some sort of keyboard now, so that's no problem. The final part, what we will be doing, is setting up your performance parameters. And that's a very important one, of course. There are eight parameters which you can control in MIDI. Some very obvious ones, like tempo control, transposition. Then you can control the MIDI velocity of the lick, the start point of the lick length, and especially the latter two are very powerful controls. You can also control the node density in the loop, that is the percentage of time that the node will actually be played and not be replaced with the rest. This way you can create some rhythmic variation. There is a deviation section, and this includes a little bit of randomness into the whole thing. Because pitch deviation and time deviation. With pitch deviation, you can control the percentage of time that not the actual note in the link will be played, but it will be replaced with a deviated note. This deviated note is not a random note. We didn't want to do that. But it is a randomly chosen note from out of a small input buffer, which you fill yourself when you're playing along with it. So in this case, you're always, you are in control of what kind of notes are being played. But you'll never know exactly which of the notes you're playing will be played back. And there's also time deviation, and with this one you can have all kinds of rhythmic shifts in a lick. And the program will try to keep up the beat of the whole lick. So especially when you're playing together and using the same lick, you can have very interesting rhythmic mixtures. The last section in this window is what we call MDL control, which stands for mini data list control. And a mini data list allows you to translate a dedicated MIDI event, let's say a driver from a modulation loop, into a stream of MIDI bytes. And this way, for example, you could translate this modulation loop event into a system exclusive message. And that's something which I will be doing when I'm playing the demo piece for you. That piece is actually an excerpt of a piece that one of my most recent pieces that I wrote. It's called Live Lines. And what I'm doing is I will be translating modulation view information into system exclusive parameters for the Kawai K1. And in this way you can quite dramatically change the timbre of the sound much more than you would only do with some kind of velocity control.
You say as a modulation loop.
Well, it means that I'm controlling the MIDI event modulation loop, which is controller number one.
So it's just punching.
Yeah, that's right.
But on
you
the
can
action.
Use in the performance window, you can set up so that actually any MIDI event can be used to control something. You can use, for example, a key number, its velocity, to control the tempo of a link. Of course, you can also use pitch bend or aftertouch or phony key pressure, whatever. You can set up your
sound. And what's the physical control?
On the conductor, the physical control, what I'm using there, is the distance between the two hands. And so I'm using the ultrasound system. And on the MIDI conductor there are actually, I can use four continuous controllers, because we have two ultrasound systems, one for the horizontal positioning measurement and the other one for the vertical positioning measurement. And with shift keys I can toggle between one controller or another. During a performance, at any moment you can always go into step mode. This is a special mode of playing with the licks. Normally a lick, of course, when you activate it, will play back the sequence with its original timing data. But when you're going into step mode, you are able to step to all the events in the lick. And what happens is when you activate the lick, the first event will play and then the program stops. And as soon as you send a MIDI trigger, and that might be any MIDI trigger or a dedicated event, you will continue with the next event in the lick. And there are all kinds of ways of controlling the several step modes. You can go stand backwards or forward through the, it's quite a powerful feature to talk. If you want to know about a little bit more about that, you should ask me after the lecture, because it will be getting too much into detail. Okay. So now what I'll do is play this excerpt for you.
Thank you.
discussion of flexible webs, but I have the latest offshore manufactured version of the web here. Show you. It's really nice to be able to describe an idea which is so also self-explanatory. Well, as soon as everybody sees this, they say, yeah, sure, okay, I get it. I want it. But the problem, there's two problems. One is to be able to continue to use human gesture in a complicated way. And the other problem is to be able to control multiple parameters at the same time with human control. And this is wonderful because it lies right at the cross point of those two problems. And I think what's most interesting about this is that it's sort of an anti-joystick. I mean, the joystick is the pure Cartesian approach to controller. A brilliant idea, which is really pretty useless for controller music, both because it is so orthogonal, so independent of everything else, but also so effortless. It has no, it offers no, we have no resistance at all. But this particular idea is based on the natural physics of the web. And just poke at it a few times and remind you if you haven't thought about it before, which I'm sure everybody has. But the idea ultimately would be to manufacture something in which there'd be a sensor at every cross point, and you'd be able to measure the tensor space of this web. And we have a prototype version, which is much simpler version of it, because it's something Michelle actually ripped up in the week. In the basement of Stein, this woodworking shop. And it's basically a bunch of Yamaha DX7 pressure pads cut into one and a half centimeter pieces. And now they work down to the smallest size you can cut. And these are just wired directly as analog inputs, just resistive inputs to the sensor lab. And a little bit of guitar machine and sort of tense the strings. Not too important at this point, because again, this is just a prototype. But I think you can see right away the possibilities of instrument like this. Clearly, it is something you can put your hand on. And the possibilities seem to be limited only by the speed and intelligence of your response shape and software. Clearly, what you're losing right away is the rational structure of an orthogonal controller, meaning a controller in which all pieces of control are isolated from every other. This one has the opposite effect. Every time you pull one, you're pulling all of them. It's just varying in greater and lesser degree, so you can see the north-south effect. It's very different. The nice thing about that is it gives you a really complicated space of interconnectivity. It's the non-orthogonality that's interesting here. Now, you may think that's a problem. Of course it's a problem. But the thing is, it's something you can clean up in software later. You can rescale all over the place once you've discovered what it is you're looking for. So this is a tool for a recording gesture, discovering, accessing gesture. But more than that, it's a tool for searching complicated spaces of lots of parameters. Say, for example, the DSP instrument, which has scads of possible control inputs, and you're trying to find which ones are actually interesting musical ones. And it's faster to do something like this and listen with your ear than it is to enter a number into painstaking keyboard and wait to see what it sounds like. And unfortunately, the examples we're going to show you are mapping the information into just high-level musical parameters, because we don't have DSP working in a way that we can crash the face. It should be ready, but it's not. So this is going to be connected to Max and playing like 802 now at a fairly high level. And let's see, I think the best thing to do here is just go on with the demonstration, but give you an idea that it really does work. It's such a simple instrument, you'll have to come up and see how basically simple the construction is. I'm sure everybody has a better idea how to make something like this. So, it's nice you can see
this first thing that you can see the sliders representing the eight senses.
But one of the most brilliant ideas which I come up with at web is the idea that you go through the space searching. You go into the space and search and find a particular configuration that's interesting, and then say stomp on the foot pedal and freeze that and then release the web, and that will become a new zero point on the web. So you recalibrate to an interesting location, search to find the location, and then have a way to touch a switch, for example, or a foot pedal, or maybe one of the sensors is a switch, something like that. And then go into a different state where you're nuancing, where you're doing delicate control on interesting individual combinations. And you don't always have to use all the dimensions of control. You're free to cut any of them off if you want. I think basically the only limitation here is the consuming machines, in this case MIDI. And it is, of course, a limited resolution system, but it's a team of God. Let's start.
Thank you.
last patch is a demonstration of what we call sort of inverter patch. It means actually that the more I will be doing, the less you will hear. And, well, it's a little bit of a contradiction from effort, which I was talking about. But for people who want to do everything the other way around, it shows you that you can use the web as well. In this patch, actually, each wire triggers a link.
People who had only their own personal eccentricity and own particular approach to music. And I think the only common ground is, as I said, the performance approach. Most all, meaning 99% of people who go to religious side, are making live performances of real-time applications as opposed to tapes. And we have tapes too, but our primary use of the studios actually is a rehearsal space and a place to listen to music and to debug your pieces and instruments. And if you feel that you have an idea in that way, please just come talk to us now or send us a letter so that you can address us here.